1997, Tony Blair becomes Prime Minister. James Cameron releases his blockbuster Titanic. And it's also the year that five fresh-faced teens join a line-dancing pop band.
Hi, Princess!
Steps soon took the British pop charts by storm, but it was only when they released a cover of the Bee Gees' classic Tragedy that they were catapulted into superstardom.
What they did is phenomenal. They were the best pantomime act I've ever seen. You know, they were right for the time.
I think Steps did a great version of Tragedy. It was a good production, and it was a good recording. They sang well on the record.
Just lovely, clean, fun, squeaky, silly pop.
And the public lapped it up. The band won a Brit Award for Best Live Act, sold 15 million records worldwide, had 14 consecutive top five hits, and sold over a million concert tickets.
People bought a ticket, walked into that arena, and all their worries went, and they just loved Steps.
But suddenly, the pressure of global success took its toll.
It just became normal for us to rock up to Top of the Pops every week, do our thing, jet off to Japan.
Couldn't really have a life. We worked about 16-hour days every single day.
I was getting on stage and couldn't even bother to smile because I just did not have the energy to do it.
December the 22nd, 2001, Manchester's MEN Arena. 1 hour before they were due on stage, H and Claire dropped a bombshell.
H and Claire resigned.
I think the last person I saw was...
Pop sensation Steps have announced this afternoon that they're to split up.
In the years after, Claire and H got together and formed a duo. The other band members attempted solo music careers, but none of them were able to recapture the success of Steps, and they disappeared off to the four corners of the earth. Steps' bitter breakup was far from the storybook ending any of the band had hoped for. Especially as they'd shared such a fairy tale beginning.
I'm Lisa.
Hello, I'm H.
Hello, I'm Faye.
Hi, I'm Lee.
And I'm Claire.
And we're Steps!
Back in the summer of 97, top TV exec Tim Byrne ran an ad in the Stage newspaper inviting hopefuls to audition for a pop group with a twist.
Faye stood out, tall, blonde. Lisa stood out, small, cute, with dark hair. And Claire stood out to me. If I'm really honest, it was her voice. And I think every girl in that room sort of went, oh no.
I remember Claire, and I remember thinking she had a fantastic voice. They were talked about her weight, because you know, she had a, it was like a figure hugging outfit. I think that was the concern.
That was when they told me that if they really liked me and they liked my voice, but if I wanted to be in the band, I had to lose weight.
When I phoned Mum at sort of the end of the day at the audition and said, Mum, I think I'm in a line dancing pop group, she said, that's nice, darling. I'm kind of left it there.
I actually went for two auditions on that day. I went for a cruise ship and I went for Steps. And I got them both. And I remember turning the cruise ship offer down. And my friends thought I was mad. Because I'd turned down a cruise around the world for a line dancing pop star.
And against all odds, these techno line dancers' debut single racked up 4 months in the UK charts, prompting pop impresario Pete Waterman to sign them up. Pete's vision was to recreate the sound of ABBA, and combined with easy-to-follow dance moves, they quickly won the hearts of a nation of teens.
Band ever.
It escalated so fast, I think that it kind of went a little bit out of control for my liking.
Couldn't really have a life. We worked about 16-hour days every single day.
You're tired, shut up.
I care.
Just be quiet.
It's not fair. We're supposed to love each other, not tell each other to shut up.
I think as we worked harder and people grew more and more tired, the little squabbles would come to the surface.
You know, if I wanted a little bitch about Lisa, maybe I'd go to Claire. If I wanted a bitch about Claire, go to Lisa, you know, it was that petty.
Beneath the smiley exterior, tensions were brewing. But petty squabbles soon escalated into serious rivalries as they recorded their third single.
Pete Waterman liked to do this thing where we all sat in the studio, he played the whole album, and then he played the single, which was One for Sorrow. I wanted your love, and look what
it's done to me. Always remember the girls' faces, knowing that Claire was going to be singing lead on that song, and they were gutted.
I remember somebody saying, why is she singing the lead vocal? Why is it just Claire? And it, from that moment, it was like, not good, really, after that. And it was just a bit weird. And I think the others all got up and left the room.
One for Sorrow marked a new direction for the band, and it proved an instant hit, going straight in the charts at number two.
But I think what was difficult was then Pete Waterman and the producers, they thought that's how it should be for every song.
We were all trying to get a line in, you know. You don't want to be a singer in a pop band and not sing. It's always first verse Claire, second verse Nelly, and Lisa speak.
I then always just felt like I was just on my own, and it was not them against me, but it was always just a bit, I felt very uncomfortable. And but also didn't feel like I was going to say, OK, I won't sing this one, you have it. Because I wanted to sing.
And it wasn't just the girls who were feeling sidelined. Lee had initially taken the lead on 5, 6, 7, 8, but he feared he was fading into the background.
There was a couple of instances in the band where it was very much pointed out to me that I was there for my look and not my voice, which obviously is not very fair and, you know, it disheartens you.
He was given the least amount of vocals and the least chance to prove himself. And that must have been really hard.
I can sing. I auditioned, you heard me sing. If I'm crap, you wouldn't have picked me. You know, let's be honest. I might not have the massive voice, but I've got a decent voice. Decent enough to do a few lines here and there, come on. I would make a point and go, you haven't put me on this. Don't care what you say. It might be blended in the background, but I can't hear it. So why should I go out there and mime it?
But back in June 1999, Steps Mania was sweeping the nation. Tragedy had become their anthem, dominating charts across Europe, Asia and Australasia. But one place that success had so far eluded them was America.
We waited to come to America till last because we wanted to have a bit of a success story to tell. We've sold 3 million albums worldwide, we've been everywhere, and America to us is just another challenge.
And they were given the luckiest break imaginable. Global megastar Britney Spears had invited them to support her on her 56-date tour across the length and breadth of North America. Baby, one more time. Signed to the same record label, H and Britney had become mates a few years before.
We spent time together. She was a lovely girl, and we just clicked, really. It was nice.
Come on, everybody, Miss Britney Spears!
We were in America doing the Britney tour. I remember that we were all going to be staying in a hotel, then flying to each next venue every day together. But the four of us cancelled all of our flights to try and claw back some costs, but H wouldn't do that.
I suffer with insomnia quite a lot, and they were happy to sleep on a tour bus, which for me, I just couldn't do. So the sensible thing for me to do was to travel with Britney.
But I think when some people are flying and it can seem to be, you know, diva-ish. There was that divide there. Four of us were on the tour bus and obviously going across the Rocky Mountains or wherever it was, and he was flying. And I do think that got people's backs up.
H wouldn't travel on the bus with us because of his whole sleep thing, even though the way I remember it, I don't really remember getting to any hotel later than like 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, so it wasn't like we actually had to sleep on the tour bus.
But H was also hiding a secret that, once exposed, would irreversibly change the band dynamic forever. His relationship with founder and manager of Steps, Tim Byrne.
Tim and I, we started our relationship really early on in the band, but we actually didn't tell anybody for... We actually managed to keep it quiet for maybe 2 or 3 years. So it was nobody's business, and we didn't want it to affect our working relationship with anybody.
But eventually he couldn't contain his secret anymore and confessed all to best friend Claire.
Because I was travelling a lot on my own, Claire became friends with the others on this tour coach and, of course, spilled the beans.
I just couldn't lie anymore, I suppose, and I didn't outright just say, oh, guess what, everybody, H and Tim are seeing each other. It wasn't like I just, out of spite, told them. It was they asked me and I just didn't say no anymore.
The whole H and Tim thing was, it was difficult, you know? You can't choose who you love, but, you know, why did it have to be our manager?
I did feel betrayed. I did. I felt let down and I thought it was unprofessional.
When you're in a band like that, it's not a lot that goes on that you don't know about within the five of you. So for them to be told that actually two members in that band have had this relationship for years, and, you know, it's a gay thing and it's a management, and that didn't really bother me. It was the fact that they'd hid it. Well, if they can keep that a secret, what else can they keep secret? And that's how I started thinking.
For a long time after that, H and I, it was just, we went from being best friends to just, he hated me.
You know, everything we stood for was friends. You know, it was just out the window. Yeah, so there were big ructions. I forgave her because I'm quite forgiving, really.
The rest of the clique was not quite so forgiving. Publicly, they maintained a united front, but privately, friendships were in tatters as paranoia took hold.
We all reacted quite strongly, and it seemed to me that things weren't equal anymore and that we weren't all on a level footing as I'd envisaged it. And I was worried that there would be favouritism. And I think I was right to be worried.
Hello there and welcome to the show, I'm here.
Actually, Hayes, you know what? Just before you sign the show, we'd just like you to sign
And as telly offers flooded in for one particular member of the group, this further fueled the fire.
I was blonde, I was kind of cute, so I was getting kind of magazine covers. I was always requested to go on TV shows. You know, I would always be asked to do the sketches on SMTV.
Here to the Queen's Royal Regiment at your service.
I would always be the first one that they would ask to do something. But I think they saw that as Tim pushing me forward. But it wasn't that case at all. It was just that I had a big gob and I was blonde.
When H started to dominate the vocals too, his bandmates felt he may be getting preferential treatment.
You're only natural to look at a situation and go, there's a manager with part of the band member here. Of course he's going to put them to the front. Of course he's going to make them favourite. I'm not going to say H has got this amazing voice and mine isn't.
I kind of then got dropped for H to start singing verses, and from being a featured singer, I guess, through the first couple of albums, I featured less and less, and H featured more.
But still the band limped on. In the summer of 2001, when news of a greatest hits album was announced, rumours were rife that a split was on the cards.
Go on, then. Go on,
okay, right.
Question.
OK, where are we? I've got one from Stacey Richards, and it says, is it true that you're splitting up?
No!
If so, you're making a big mistake, because I think you're fab.
Oh,
thank you, Stacey.
I think we'd know we'd be making a mistake. We're not splitting up. Again, it's a rumour. We don't know where it's come from, but we're very much together.
But just 7 months later, during their most ambitious UK tour to date, two members had reached breaking point.
I knew I couldn't have gone on anymore. I think I would have gone a bit mad if I had. I never kind of naturally felt happy, even on stage in the end. It was just, it was too hard to be there anymore. I didn't want to be there.
We were earning millions of pounds, and I'm not bragging, but, you know, it was just immense, the amount of money we were earning. But it just wasn't worth it for me. I wanted my life back.
I got to the point where I just thought, I can't do this anymore. I cannot turn up to work and be in such... You could have cut the atmosphere with a knife. It was horrible. I had to share a dressing room with the girls. And it was just, we barely spoke to each other. I just thought the only way I could deal with it was to take myself out of the equation and just walk away.
I wanted normality, I wanted my friends, I wanted my family, and I wanted anonymity again. Just wanted my life back.